One of my close friends at school, his name is Dan Anthony, has a son who's named Rowdy. And this guy is a part of the special ops in the war. He is an older man. In other words, he's in his 30s. He has a family, has several children. He is actually in the medical part of the special ops. When he goes in, he takes care of anybody that goes down while they're right there. But he's also trained to work. Right now, they won't let him out of Kuwait because he's doing all the surgeries and helping them in their surgeries. But he has been a part of all these drops that you've heard, and he was in there way before the war began. Okay? In other words, they dropped special ops way before the battle started. And he was a part of that. He volunteers for all of them. He was in Afghanistan. Okay? Well, this is very disconcerting for a father and for a mother, I mean a wife who has children. And it isn't, he always raises his hand in any mission. He is Rowdy, I mean, goes right with his name. Okay? And he knows that. Okay? They know that about him. And when she married him, she knew that was what was going to be. Okay? In terms of what was going on. So when Dan, I remember I was going out and getting my car, and out came Dan. He came running out to the parking lot, and he came to me and he said, "He's going in." Now that was about 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago. He said, "I don't know where he's going in, but he's going in." He had tears in his eyes because he knew there was very. In fact, his son told him, "I may not come back. Okay, it's that dangerous." And so he asked me to pray for him. And so that particular point, and most of us have felt this as we've gone through the situation in the last 2 weeks, is an unease that's a part of us. And you listen to the news and you see things and things change and they slow and they go up and down. And there's this unease that's a part of us in terms of that. And mine was particularly an unease, not only what I saw, but also for this young man, okay, and the heart of my friend. In terms of what was going on, where does a man go in the sun age? Goes to himself. You know, where does he go? You know, there are no atheists in a foxhole, but still, okay. Where does a man find the truth, the real beauty of God? Okay. Well, I came home that night and just basically started opening the Word, praying and reading, doing just like David was saying, seeking the beauty of God, seeking his person, seeking words from his soul about what I should do and how I should feel and where I should be. Okay? Now, where does a man get that? Okay? Except having the opportunity to find that in God. On any kind of thing that's called the day of the trouble. Okay? And so when I went in there, it didn't take me but 5 minutes, and God was ministering in terms of this. Seeing verses I'd never seen, thinking verses that I've known forever, you know, and finding the soul of God to produce rest. Okay? And that's exactly what David is talking about here. In the day of trouble, I will be found seeking him and his beauty. I know him. I know him. I know his heart. I know his power. I know his soul. I know him. I know his beauty. And I'm telling you because I'm the teacher. In other words, I got the floor. But I could give any one of you an opportunity to do the same thing. See, that's what we're talking about. But if that has not occurred, literally, you have missed the point. Okay? That is the upward call. Well, let me tell you real quick what God shared with me. Okay? Just to help you, maybe, in terms of that. Because to me, it was like God pouring out a peace. Okay, in relationship, particularly about this young man's life. I really wasn't thinking of it in terms of anything but him. Okay, in relationship to his life. In Psalm 89, verse 48, and I'm just going to read these real quickly to you, what man can live and not see death? Or save himself from the power of the grave? What man, not any of us, can live and not see death? And who among us can save ourselves from the power of the grave? Nobody on the face of this earth can protect or deliver Rowdy but God. Rowdy was a young man who loves God. And he is in the arena of death on a consistent basis. Okay? And he's a young man who finds his trust that God is in his life in terms of this. Now, there are two things that can happen in terms of Rowdy. He can live or he can die, okay, in that arena. And what does God say about either one of those options? Okay, because this young girl who has been brought back, there's another one who's set right next to her who is gone now. Okay, and those are the two options. And what does God say about both options? What does a man who is a part of him rest? Where does a woman who is married to Rowdy rest in relationship to this? I mean, I'm only a friend far away. I don't even know who Rowdy is in terms of seeing him. Okay. Well, in Psalm 57, this is the verse that I came across that I've never sunk in any kind of thing. And I was just reading, I read about five chapters here and ran across this verse. And it says, oops, I'm in the wrong place. Isaiah 57, 1 and 2. The righteous man perishes, and no man takes it to heart. The devout men are taken away, while no one understands. That'd be a question if Rowdy was taken away. Left his wife and children, and this friend of mine, a father, hurt. This is Isaiah 57, verse 1. And then it says, "For the righteous man is taken away from evil. He enters into peace. They rest in their beds. Each one who walked in his upright way." What you find in the mind and the heart of God is an attitude towards death that is a release. It's a release. Rowdy is in the control of God. If Rowdy was to be taken home to God, that would be precious. It will be removal from the very thing that he is against. In other words, he is fighting evil. He would be removed from the source of evil itself and taken into the very presence of God. And precious is the death of one who is a saint in the eyes of God. There is a deep, deep rejoicing. To God, death is nothing but a door that leads into a full beauty. And to him, it's precious. And to him is a rest and a deliverance from evil. And that is, of course, what you and I have and understand. When I was looking at that and had this sense of, well, what if he goes? Okay. Well, there's this sense that God understands all that. And he will take him home to be with him in terms of that particular issue. He will remove him from the evil that's around him and every step that he makes. Okay. So that is the perspective that you find from God himself. It's from his soul. If you don't find that and see that, there's very little peace sometimes in the idea of death. Okay? And that has to come from God. A deep peace in terms of that. That's just one verse. Okay? A verse that I've not really read. Okay? But then the next thing that came inside of my mind and heart was, well, he's alive. What can I pray for him? What can I pray for his daughter, for his wife? What can I pray for my friend? What can I pray for me? Okay, in terms of the feelings and the unease. Psalm 23 came across my mind. Best known place in the Word. Beautiful, beautiful thing in terms of what's going on. Though I walk through the shadow, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. That's about as far as I got, but I went ahead and read the rest of the passage. Okay? This is talking about a valley that is the shadow of death. It is not death itself. But when you read this, most people think of death. Okay? But in reality, it's a valley that is the shadow of death. And what I'm talking about is Rowdy. Because everywhere he goes, he walks through a valley where he can really smell death. He can literally feel its cold hand come upon him. He is that close to it. Okay? And he's that close to it a lot. And my prayer is for him is that he, from God, he doesn't have to fear. He doesn't have to fear. And that God will be right with him. Right with him. Step by step, movement by movement, bullet by bullet. Okay? In terms of what God will do for him. And that should comfort his soul and his wife's soul and my friend's soul and my soul. That we have a God who is there to walk with us in the valley of the shadow of death. And that he doesn't have to fear. You know the thing that I learned the very next week from my friend? He gets emails back and forth from different people in the unit and his own son and whatnot. His own son actually has been on TV twice. They caught him. There he goes. And so he's seen him several times. But he says, you don't know how many people are coming to know God at this time. He says, the one question they ask me is why don't you fear? And he basically says, this is his answer. I died 11 years ago. What that means is that's when he became a Christian. And I gave my life to God. I am crucified with him. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but he lives in me. He calls me, he calls me. If he doesn't, then I don't fear. And there's a comfort to me. Now, in terms of that comfort, I pray that comfort reaches to his wife. I pray that comfort reaches to his children. Because they too have to go through the same valley in a different way. And yet you can pray that. And know that that's going to happen. And here's a young man who's having influence upon influence upon influence and yet taking away the evil that's a part of this world. And yet God could take him home. But at the same time, these are the things that he can hold to. Thou preparest a table in front of my enemy. In other words, the table is a table of beauty and goodness and fullness. And it's right there in front of the enemy who has no concept of knowing him. None. Because of the evil that's in their soul. And yet here's a man who knows him. Okay? And is essentially seeing all this be real and true within his own soul. Okay? An enormous, enormous statement. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And if I go, I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Enormous thing. That is the soul of God. That is to know Him and to find Him. In the middle of the day of trouble, where will you be found? You'll be found in His presence, beholding His beauty. So that's essentially what Paul is talking about. The Word has become flesh, and it's dwelt among us. And we have seen Him. We have seen His grace, and we have seen His truth. Okay? Let me read you the last thing right before we got to go here. It's out of John chapter 14. I will ask the Father, and He will give you another helper, that He may be with you forever. That is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it does not behold Him or know Him. But you know Him, because He abides with you, and He will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. After a little while, the world will behold me no longer, but you will behold me. Because I live, you shall also live. And that day you shall know that I am in the Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Verse 21 states at the very end of that verse, I will disclose myself to you. That's from the soul and the heart of God. That's available to know Him. Okay, see you not next week, but the week after. We'll talk about the power of the resurrection. Mm-hmm.